Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. As usual, here I am. Just wanted to make a quick video. I just can't say that with a straight face. No, I will try to keep this video short. I just wanted to give you guys some updates. Number one, you know, I made the last video I made, I'd given a word from the Lord, a word of knowledge from the Lord, that Brother Gary would get a message from the Lord. It would be for the nation. And just the next day or two, Brother Gary made the video saying that this word about the you know, the whole United States, East Coast, whatever, being wiped out by the tsunami and all this stuff was not going to happen. And I believe that is the word, because it is for the nation. Prophecy is about, like, basically almost the whole United States being destroyed by this asteroid causing a giant tsunami. And I believe that is the word that the Lord intended him to give. And I believe that is the, you know, fulfillment of the word of knowledge that I gave. That Brother Gary Bear 049 would have a word for the Lord. So I'll try to put the link under here, his latest video. I believe it's a fulfillment of the word that the Lord gave me, that he would have a message for the nation and people need to hear him. Now, whether he will get more messages, of course, that's up to the Lord. But I believe Gary Bear 049 does hear from the Lord. He's heard lots of, and just to mention this, he's heard, you know, you have to have a proven track record. People hear lots of stuff, and there's no proven track record of some of these people. Like this guy who made that prophecy, I don't know anything about no track record for him. But Brother Gary has had dreams from the Lord and given specific dates or places and names and people and you know, about so many Israeli soldiers would be killed or whatever, and all this kind of detailed stuff, very detailed technical stuff about a bomb and all this kind of stuff that's turned out to be true. I don't know how many of those things he put in videos. Maybe he did, but he personally told me, and then it came to pass many times, brothers and sisters, many times. And so the Bible says, you know, let everything be established by two or more witnesses. So I'm a witness. Brother Gary's heard many times from the Lord. That doesn't make anybody perfect or anybody some kind of, you know, one of the two witnesses and all this kind of stuff. But it means that, you know, we can, the Bible says that there's gifts of the Spirit and we can operate in those gifts. Words of wisdom, words of knowledge, prophecy, you know, all the gifts there that's listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And then there's also, there's the offices. You know, a lot of times, I don't even want to get into a teaching on that. Sometimes people get the offices, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12. Along in there, you'll read, you know, he gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. There's the office of, like, someone in a prophetic office. There are New Testament prophets. It's right there in the Bible. And in the book of Acts, there are several people, like Agabus, who is a prophet. And then there's one of the offices in the New Testament. We see in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, it's the prophet. But someone can have the gift, operating the gift of prophecy, which is to be spoken in the church with, you know, exhortation for the church. And then there's the office, a ministry office, an elder in the church. I've done videos about that. You can go look at my channel. So as an example that I'm on that topic, someone will say something like, they'll quote from there where it says that the gift of prophecy is for exhortation. It's like in along in there, 1 Corinthians chapter 12 through 14. Really covers this topics about the gifts of the Spirit, one of the primary areas to look at. And it says that the gift of prophecy is for edifying the church. Well, that is the gift of prophecy, where you utter a word in the church. Someone stands up. Anybody who has the gifts of the Spirit, flowing in the Spirit, in the praise and worship, they begin to give an utterance, like someone speaks in tongues and they need an interpreter. You know, and that interpretation is also, you know, the prophecy. As it says, Paul said it's better to prophesy unless someone interprets when you speak in tongues, so everyone can understand, everyone can hear what you're saying. And then that word that goes forth, that is a prophecy, and it's to edify the church. But now someone who is in the office of a prophet, that's where God uses them to exhort and rebuke and all those things. So that's the difference. So when you hear someone say, as an example, someone gets up in the church and gives a prophetic utterance, and it's some kind of a rebuke or attack or chastisement, that's not in accordance with the word of God, that the gift of prophecy flows in edifying the church. Now, it can be like, oh, the church needs to repent, something like that. That's, now that it ends up being edifying. Repent and God's going to bless the church, even though it may have a rebuke to it. This church is not walking in the will of God, and the Lord says if we all repent, He's going to bless us and use us to plant churches all around the world, as an example. Okay, just an example there. So that would still be edifying, but you know what I'm saying. Not getting up and rebuking without that exhortation. But the office of a prophet usually is dealing with leadership, either in the government or in the church. You know, who are out of the will of God, just like John the Baptist. He came out and said, you know, King Herod has got his brother's wife. And that's why his brother's wife wanted his head on a silver platter, you know, and got her daughter, which is really the niece of King Herod, to do this dance for him. And then he said, I'll give you anything you want, even half the kingdom. She said, give me the head of John the Baptist on a silver platter, because that's what her mother wanted, Herodias, because John the Baptist was saying, hey, this, you know, you're shacked up with your brother-in-law here. And that's not right. And so that's why she wanted to get vengeance. That old Jezebel spirit in her, she couldn't stand it. So she wanted to destroy the Elijah spirit that was in John the Baptist. Just like when Elijah dealt with Jezebel and Ahab. King Herod and his wife, Herodias, is the same kind of a spiritual thing going on there. But anyway, so the office of a prophet as a preacher, you know, a preacher, an elder, a preacher who is a prophet. There are, elders, preachers who are pastors, and there are some that are evangelists, some that are teachers. And, and then there's the apostolic office, which is really establishing a new denomination. I made videos about this. Really a modern day, the word apostle, there's the 12 apostles, and then there are other apostles. Sent ones, it means sent one. The Bible calls Jesus an apostle. So an apostle is a sent one. And just to touch on this, actually missionaries operate really in the realm of what the apostles do, in the fact that, like, Paul was not one of the 12. He was a later addition apostle. The Bible calls several other people apostles in the book of Acts. If you do a word search, you'll see there's other people who are called apostles. It simply means a sent one to a plant and establish churches. And that's basically, as I said, what missionaries do. You go into an area that's unreached. There's no Christians there. You go in there, you evangelize. You recognize people who are called to be pastors. You train them, you know, you baptize them, you train them, you instruct them. You're like the bishop over that area, really, but you're establishing a new work. And then that's usually ends up lots of times being a denomination. As an example, as I mention all the time, John Wesley established a Methodist church. And it brought in, you know, a mighty move of holiness. One of the leaders of the holiness movement at the time of the Great Awakening, the American Revolution time period, really operated in the office of apostle. Martin Luther operated in the office of an apostle. Those kind of guys like that. Down through history, there's been people who have done that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I didn't really want to get into that teaching. I just want to discuss that. And, as the Holy Spirit would lead me. I also want to add on here, thank the Lord, our PayPal, our new PayPal was frozen for one day. And, I thought it was going to be a repeat of what happened with our other PayPal in Australia, but what ended up happening is that Brother Peter, they just wanted more information about the account. You know, he tried to keep himself as anonymous as possible, but because they're doing international stuff, you know, it popped up a red flag. They froze the account, and then when he gave them, you know, who he was and everything, and he explained it to them. He wrote a letter and explained to them what we're doing, and everything's great. You know, Canada is not so New World Order as America and Australia. So thank the Lord. The PayPal account is unfrozen. Everything's great. I have it down here in a bubble. I ask you to please, that's all for the Philippine operations. My PayPal, my email address is for the American, my travels and all that in the States and wherever else the Lord will send me to. By the grace of God, I'm supposed to go to Australia, New Zealand, and to the Holy Land. You know, the Lord has spoke to me about taking a group to Israel, you know. So I'm just waiting on him to finalize before we lock it in, the dates. My prayer is, and my mind from the Lord, will be next September of 2015. So we're down to almost a year. Have to lock that in so we can start planning it. So I ask you also to message me if you have a desire to go to the Holy Land. I did lots of studying even on the geography, you know, the geography of biblical times and all that. Is an area that's like one of my favorite areas to study. And if you ever get a chance, you can look at this bar. I believe you can find it online. Part of their articles, I think they may try to charge you, but Biblical Archaeological Review. You can go online, you can see all this stuff, like where they found the walls of Jericho, all this kind of stuff. I would love to go to Petra. That's in Jordan too. You know, that's where, you know, that's also Bozrah in the Bible. That's the place where the Edomites were too in their day, and it's also the place that they call it the Rose City. That's the place that is Bozrah. It's where the Israelites will be hiding from the Antichrist in the second half of the tribulation, as an example. So what they call Petra, the Rose City there, it's a natural fortification. According to the Word of God, the Israelites will hide there during the second half of the tribulation. When they discover in the first half of the tribulation, they think the Antichrist may be the Messiah. He's a cool guy. He brought peace. They're entertaining the idea that he might be a Messiah. They don't accept him as the Messiah directly, but as they're entertaining that idea, he allows them to rebuild the temple, brings peace, all that stuff. Then in the middle of the tribulation, he goes in to the literal temple in Jerusalem. People, when they're born, we're born in sin. We are not the Holy of Holies. When we become a Christian, our body is the temple of God after you become a Christian. Okay, so when someone who's a Christian, they can't choose to take the mark. If you're already born again a Christian, you cannot choose to take the mark when the time comes. So therefore, you know, you taking the mark and then, you know, you become demon possessed, satanically possessed, that is not the abomination standing in the holy place, because by definition, you're not a holy place because you're not saved and the Holy Spirit is not in you. Okay, the abomination that causes desolation standing in the holy place, spoken of by Daniel the prophet, is literally the rebuilt temple on the Temple Mount in the holy place, the Holy of Holies, inside that temple where the Ark of the Covenant is supposed to be. There will be right in front of there, you know, the Antichrist will go in there and offer a sacrifice. Like this, I can't ever pronounce his name right, Epiphanes the Fourth from Syria. When Alexander the Great died, he said, "Let my kingdom go to the strong." And, you know, and Daniel prophesied already well in advance. And when Alexander the Great did not destroy Jerusalem, because when he went there, they showed him the prophecies that talked about him, you know. And so he said, "Oh, these people really hear from the real God," and he left them alone. And then he went and died in Babylon, and he had a nosebleed. How about that? 33 years old. Anyway, this Xerxes Epiphany, whatever it is, Epiphanes the Fourth, he went in there and sacrificed a pig and put a statue of Zeus, who is the father of Apollyon. You know, Apollyon is the name of the really the Antichrist, the fallen angel who will possess a human, or literally himself will come in the form of a man. Who is the Antichrist? The Bible tells us. It's Apollyon, the beast. It's Apollyon, the beast that came out of the bottomless pit will kill the two witnesses. That's him, the mark of the beast, a mark of Apollyon. It's all right there in the Bible if you look. Not all this wild speculation on YouTube. So anyway, in the middle of the tribulation, after the first 3.5 years, the Antichrist will go there. He'll kill the two witnesses, okay? And all that happens in Revelation chapter 11. Then he will go into the holy place. He will probably do like what Epiphanes did in 165 B.C., He will sacrifice a pig. He will change law, as Daniel said. He will change the law, the times and seasons. He'll outlaw the Jews having a Sabbath day and all that stuff that he will do, just like what that Epiphanes the Fourth did back in 100 Sicilies, Epiphanes the Fourth, whatever, who did that like in 165 BC. You know, he'll do the exact same thing, you know, similar to what, you know, this, because that's a shadow of him. See, and then that's why some people try to say, well, that was already fulfilled in 165 B.C. No, because Jesus in 33 A.D. said, when you see it, you know, a future event spoken of by the prophet Daniel standing in the holy place. You know, that's when he tells the Israelites, flee to the mountains and all that. Pray that it not be on the Sabbath and not in the winter and all that. He's talking to Israel. The book of Revelation in chapter 12, it talks about, you know, the dragon coming down and chasing the woman into the wilderness and all that. That is the nation of Israel. The nation of Israel gave us the Messiah. The Messiah came from the nation of Israel. So, and then just says the dream of Joseph, just to tie back into that, the woman with the 12 stars and all that is the nation of Israel. Joseph had a dream, you know, connects to the same thing, you know, that the nation of Israel would bow down to him, the 12 stars, that's the nation of Israel, not the church. So Jesus gave birth to the church. The church didn't give birth to Jesus. So anyway, they will run it, flee into the wilderness, into that place, to Petra, which is called Bozrah in the Bible. And then when you read in Revelation, when Jesus returns, before he lands on the Mount of Olives, Zechariah chapter 14, he will come to Bozrah first. They say, who is this whose garments and vestures are dipped in blood and all this? who comes to Bozrah. So Jesus will appear to the nation of Israel in Bozrah at Petra while he's still in the air. And that's when they'll see him. That's when they'll mourn for the one they pierced, as one mourns for a firstborn son. Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10. Then he will go from there. The Israelites will follow him, you know, on the ground. They'll be going back with him. When he goes back, you know, back to, you know, after he goes about the Battle of Armageddon first and the Battle of Megiddo. He destroys the Antichrist, all them, throws them in the bottomless pit, all that stuff that he does. Then he goes to Bozrah, Petra, lets the Jews see him. They have that second chance. They receive him as the Messiah. You know, he received those wounds in the house of his brethren. It's also Zechariah chapter 14. Then he will go there and land on the ground at the Mount of Olives. It will split in two, and he'll walk through the eastern gate up to the Temple Mount. The thousand-year reign of Christ begins. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I don't know how I got into all that. Started on this video talking about Brother Gary giving that word, and then I just went all over the place, brothers and sisters. You know how I am. But it just, you know, I usually try to pray, you know, make videos at the end of my prayer time. You know, I'm just flowing as the Lord leads me. Those guys, you guys who are my regular viewers, you know what I'm talking about. God bless you guys. You know that I love all you guys. I appreciate all your help with orphanages. You know, we have these new feeding programs that we're adding as the Lord is giving us. You know, the more orphan, the new feeding programs, you know, we evangelize them. We teach them Christian songs and Christian books that we have and tell them little stories and learn these little action songs, you know, Jesus loves little children, all that stuff. Give them the gospel and everything, like Vacation Bible School every week, every Saturday and Sunday. We do most of the feedings on Saturdays and Sundays during the school year, of course, but lots of the kids don't even get to go to school. They don't have any clothes, they don't have any money. You know, you have to pay a small tuition in the Philippines and you have to have a uniform to go to public school. And it's like $20 a semester to go to school, not counting your transportation. There's no buses or anything like that. You either walk, if you live close enough, or you ride on the back of a motorcycle or whatever, or one of these tricycads, we call it. A motorcycle with a sidecar on it. Excuse me. You know, it's like 15, 20 cents a day for that. So, I mean, I would, you know, there's always opportunity. Lots of kids who I'd love to help just to go, you know, get to school, get their uniform, get them started. We could help 1,000 kids with that, you know, and so what does that cost, you know, whatever. God can provide. So there's always a need. There's always more that we can do, more people that we can help to give them the gospel and then help them get out of that, you know, the ignorance of never going to school. I mean, you know, how can you function in the world if you never went to school? How can you even understand, you know, 90% of the people, 75% of the people I've talked to in the Philippines, they only went maybe to the fifth grade. They can't hardly understand just a basic John 3:16, much less anything else. You imagine if you're born in such ignorance and poverty, and ignorance means, you know, lack of knowledge and understanding about all these things. How do you have a chance, you know, in this world, you know, to avoid becoming an alcoholic if you're a boy having 10 kids and no shoes and, you know, barefoot and pregnant, as they say, when you're 14 years old? How do you avoid that life? That's the cycle these people are in. You know, so the only intervention is really the gospel and then also those natural things, give them food. You know, give them an opportunity, let them see some hope. You know, the men, especially alcoholism, 90%, I would say, between and men in the Philippines. Hopelessness is a big part of that, you know. So we, you know, that's part of, you know, we're bringing hope and that, yeah, there is a God and he blesses his people. You know, like I say, I'm not a prosperity preacher, but lots of times people are like, you know, oh, we're supposed to go out here, you know, walk around with no shoes and all that. No, the Bible tells us, you know, to help widows and orphans. And to be a blessing to people. How can you help people if you yourself don't have anything, you know, you don't have nothing in your pocket? How can you help somebody? It's not just giving them the gospel. Because there are people that don't have nothing to eat. And you say, well, you give me the good news and Jesus is this and he's the healer and you know, he provides, he's Jehovah Jireh. Well, we don't even have nothing to eat. You know, we don't even know where our next meal's coming from. We're malnourished and, you know, we got kids dying because we don't have even a single peso to take them to the doctor. And you know, we're sickly. And then here you are, you're coming in here and you don't even have, you walked in here, you don't even have a way to get in here. You don't have any food to eat yourself. You know, where's the salt and light of, you know, the goodness of being a Christian? So we also have to demonstrate. It's not a matter of, you know, driving around, you know, in a new Mercedes Benz. But when you, you know, you have to be equipped to take the gospel with wisdom, understanding. And you have to have gas and a vehicle to go there, somebody take you and all that. And it's also salt and light. People say, hey, you know, look at my neighbor here. My neighbor became a Christian and now he got hired and got a job, you know, and none of us here have a job. This guy got a job. at some business. You know, God gave him favor. Look at the guy. He got a job. He stopped drinking. You know, he's taking his family to church. His life's turned around. He bought his kids some. His kids are going to school. He bought them some shoes. You know, wow, God's blessing him. That's a witness, salt and light. Brothers and sisters, we need to be salt and light and a blessing to people. And all these ways, Paul said, I become all things to all people that some might get saved. That's what it's all about, brothers and sisters. I keep changing topics, but you know, every time I hear people debating all this foolishness on YouTube, it kindles the anger of the Lord in my spirit. That while Rome is burning, people are fiddling while Rome is burning, as they say. In this case, no, I'm not talking about evil Rome. I'm talking about the world's going to hell in a handbasket, and people are debating and getting into all this little nitpicking stuff. When in reality, you know, there's a time for the rubber to meet the road. And I mentioned this before, one of the eccentric, well-off eccentric people that I talk to that has lots of eccentric doctrines, and all this theory stuff way off in the left field. You know, whenever I made the videos of the feeding programs and stuff, I always send this person a copy, you know, because, and they always respond to me, you know, saying that, this reminds me, you know, the whole point of Christianity. That's my point, you know, it's all about, in reality, when it boils down to it, it's not just a theory, it's not pie in the sky. That's religion, you know, it's just all this theory stuff. No, it's a reality. There's real people who are really going to hell, who are really have nothing to eat, who really don't know what the gospel is, or don't know and understand what's John 3:16. There's millions and millions, if not billion people in the world, billions in this world like that. They go to sleep tonight with nothing to eat. They can't even think about, yeah, right, where's Jesus? You know, I don't even have anything to eat. You know, I don't even know. You know what I'm saying? I think I made the point. But I appreciate all the people who the Lord has led. You know, I always put on there, too, on the Facebook group. The Facebook group link is below if you want to see some pictures. I kind of try to put up pictures almost about every day, at least one or two pictures of the different things that we're doing. But I always put stuff like, thank you to the sponsors. And I say that to you guys. But in reality, you know, thank the Lord that he led people to be sponsors, you know, people to donate. That's really what it is. The Lord is the one doing it, not me or you. And the Lord is, you know, I offered myself as a sacrifice to be used for God for his will. And, you know, the Lord has used me some. I wish he would use me 100 times more. I wish we could build 100 orphanages. You know, I wish that the Lord would let me, you know, have a video that 1 million people would see, you know, and get saved or whatever. It's up to the Lord. You know, I mean, he's the one who's in charge. So the same thing for all the people who would donate. God is the one that would lead people to donate. God is the one who would give people the ability to donate, you know, and give them the opportunity, not just Joshua's ministry, any work of the Lord, whatever it may be. Now, brothers and sisters, let's get in the game. That's all I can tell you. You know, there's times to take a break, you know, and then there's times to be at bat, and there's times to sit down and be quiet, and then there's times to get in, you know, the game as the coach, the Lord Jesus Christ would put us in. You know, get in the game. If you're able to get in the game, get in the game. And I got some, like Brother Peter, you know, he's thinking about coming to Philippines. I've had several people say they want to come to Philippines. They haven't come yet over there to visit and do some ministry work. You know, I'm open to that too. I've had some people say they want to come over there and party and then explore the possibility of whether they might serve the Lord. Now, I'm not going to have that. I had to tell them, no, you can't come to Philippines and party. And think about whether if the Lord wants to call you, it's all about them. And that's probably the biggest problem with short-term mission trips, brothers and sisters. See how many different topics can I cover in a video, you know? You know, lots of times people think about doing mission trips for their own personal growth. I don't think people think about what I'm saying. They don't think about it, that, you know, it's not about us. It's about the Lord. It's not even about helping other people. And that's a whole other video. See, I've already given 10 different talks in this video. It's not even about other people in the fact that it's about the Lord doing his will, serving the Lord, bringing glory to the Lord. Our job is to bring glory to the Lord, bringing glory to his name, whatever that is. If the Lord, it ends up that you getting fed to the lions, or we get fed to the lions to bring glory to the Lord. Hey, that's awesome. You know, that's let the Lord's will be done. If the Lord makes a way that ends up that you're going to be a, you know, that you're going to inherit $100 million and you're going to build a thousand orphanages to bring glory to his name? That's awesome. I'll be glad to help you do it, facilitate it in the Philippines or anywhere the Lord would lead you. And I'd be glad to try to help you put it together. If the Lord leads that, you know, whatever it is, he wants you to go, you know, shine the shoes of people and take that money and you know, and buy Bibles and give them away. Whatever it takes to bring glory to the Lord. That's what it's all about. Secondarily, it's about helping other people. And then lastly, it's about yourself. You know, I talk about that all the time. The joy, Jesus, others, yourself, last. God bless you guys. I try to break a record of speaking the most topics in one video. You know that I know that I love all of you guys who, you know, I communicate with you guys. And I really appreciate it, the fellowship and friendship. You know, when I was in the Philippines, I went months without seeing another native English speaker, months at a time. And then if I did see one and went to a big city like Manila or Davao and met some that they're basically drunks. I met very few, you know, Christians. Brother Joey is about the only one there in Davao who works with the gypsies of the Philippines. But anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless all you guys. I appreciate your time and watching the videos that I make. I appreciate your feedback and positive comments. And even, you know, sometimes you guys give me comments and, you know, like something that I might have said wrong or missed. And I mean, if you're right, you're right. And, you know, I appreciate that too. And love, an honest debate and discussion is nothing wrong with that. In love, I mean, you know, we can discuss it as brothers and sisters in Christ. That's what it's all about. You know, fellowshipping in the bond of peace, as the Bible says. You know, I appreciate all of you guys. God bless all of you guys.